Next day, new adventures. But first, a filling breakfast. Then Peter and I hopped on the metro to almost the Hofburg. Peter and I jumped on the Straßenbahn for a short trip from the city center to the relatively newly restored Liechtenstein Museum. We're going to spend the whole morning there. What you know of Liechtenstein is that it was a tax haven in the Alps, run by a prince. Well, it's the smallest German-speaking country in the world. It's bordered by Switzerland and Austria, not Germany. In ancient times, this Austrian family owned vast estates in Moravia, Lower Austria, Silesia, and Styria. By 1917, they bought the Herrschaft von Schellenberg and the county of Vaduz. This gave them the much-sought-after seat on the Reichstag, the imperial diet. As a true principality, it didn't really come into its own until after World War I, and Austria became a republic. This is Prince Franz Joseph II, who was prince from 1938 till his death in 1998. It was he who took all the artwork from our palace in Vienna by 1948 to keep it out of the hands of the Russians. His son, Hans Adam II, was the one who oversaw the extensive restoration of the palace, particularly the frescoes and stucco work. The Liechtenstein Museum is considered the best private collection of paintings in the world. The current Prince Regent, a linguist, lawyer, and a graduate of the Military College of Sandhurst, is now in charge of the day-to-day running of the principality. Typical of the 19th century, the Liechtensteins had two palaces, the winter one on the Bankgasse, and this, their summer one, in the Russo section of Wien. The famous Austrian frescoist Johann Michael Rothmeier, his works had fallen into disrepair due to water damage and were frescoed over. These were recovered and restored in the 2002 to 2004 restoration. This is the Eastern Stairway fresco. It is the admittance of the military genius into Olympus. A youth representing military genius, of course that represents Prince Johann Adam Andreas I, born aloft by Minerva. This is the Western Stairway. Battle of the gods against the giants. In the center, Zeus is borne aloft by an eagle with a fistful of thunderbolts. Minerva, protected by an image of the Medusa, joins in. Meantime, the giants hurl boulders. This is another of Rothmeier's frescoes, Andromeda taken up to Olympus. He was not an unknown quantity. He'd done extensive work in Salzburg and was an appointed artist to the imperial court. This is a close-up. Notice the delightful intensity of colors. For this work, he went through 19 books of leaf gold. The Hercules Hall of the Summer Palace. It's the work of Andrea Poggio, 1642 to 1709, as mentioned in my DVD Italy, Volume 1. He was the renowned Jesuit lay brother, famous mathematician, Baroque painter, architect, and designer, who had done the dome and the nave of St. Ignatius in Rome. He was introduced to the prince, Johann Adams Andreas I, by Prince Anton Florian, imperial emissary to the papal court in Rome. This is the Deeds of Hercules and his admittance into Olympus. A close-up of one of his deeds, the triumph over Antaeus. This is infant Hercules strangling serpents sent to him by Hera. There's some fine ceiling stucco work. Here is one of the allegory of the art of drawing. This one represents winter, white on white. Marcantonio Franceschini, 1648-1729, a Bolognese Baroque painter, was supposed to do all the palace's frescoes, but could only be inveigled to do some 26 paintings. He was also the prince's buyer of paintings. This is Apollo and Diana slaying the Python. This is the birth of Apollo and Diana. Love the blues. Venus and Adonis hunting. For Marc Antonio, important was uniform employment of light and colors that were subordinate to form. Turning now to just a soupçon of the many paintings here. This is The Punishment of Hercules by Pietro da Cortona, 1596 to 1669, a much overlooked Baroque painter. Hercules is punished for a murder he committed. He sits humiliated, having to put on a woman's red dress and play the woman, the weak woman, to the hilt. Antony van Dyck, 1599-1641. Looks like a young Salvador Dali, doesn't he? In 1630, he did the portrait of the 19-year-old Maria de Tassi's daughter of the imperial postmaster in Antwerp. Very nouveau riche. Just look at the lustrous dress, décolleté and French haute couture. Look at the detail of the lace collar and the ostrich fan. One of Tony's masterpieces. From the Grand Ducal Workshops of Firenze, a badminton cabinet by Baccio Capelli. Bronze figures by Girolamo Ticchiati. It's a very special type of mosaic called pietre dure, literally hard rocks. There are three types of mosaic, the Venetian small rectangular pieces grouted together, Roman very small round pieces like petit point, and Florentine pietre dure, very large pieces of semi-precious stone. This looks like an oil painting, but it is actually a mosaic made from varying sizes of large pieces of semi-precious stones, seamlessly abutting one another. It's pietre dure! Another example of this fantastic art, made even more so by the use of the colorization of the stone to represent the landscape. This elevated style is called Commessi di Pietre Dure. This is the masterpiece of Peter Paul Rubens, the centerpiece of the entire museum. He painted it in 1616 to 17. It's the seven painting series of Livy's story of the War of the Romans against the Latins. It's the death and triumph of the Roman consul Decius Mus. D-E-C-I-U-S-M-U-S. Both consuls of the Roman army have the same dream. The Roman army will be victorious, but one of the two consuls will die. Rubens only paints Decius Mus telling the dream. The augur is consulted to find out which consul will have to sacrifice his life. Two bulls are slaughtered, the livers removed. Decius's bull is found to have a missing piece, known by the augur as the head. His fate is sealed. The Roman high priest consecrates Decius Mus to his fate. Decius dismisses his 12 lictors, bodyguards, to go and tell the other consul that he's the one who will sacrifice his life. There he is, hopping on his horse to go into the thick of battle and die. The pièce de résistance, a spear through his neck, his horse in Lavade. You'll see Lavades today if you see the evening performance at the Spanish Riding School in the Hofburg. What a painting, monster! The colors, the action, the conflict, the sacrifice that spurs his men to victory. After that, it's the letdown. Here, Decius is lying in state. The battle trophies erected on the battlefield. What a way to end our visit to the Liechtenstein Museum. Monster. We need some relaxation and sustenance after all the emotional expenditure. Downtown beckons. Yo! It's Doe and Co. Zola, unsere Zola, mein Liebling. Come, be attentive to our needs. Restored back to health and rested, Peter and I plunge headlong to the outstanding Belvedere, the palatial residence of the Prince of Savoy. Prince Eugene of Savoy, 1663 to 1736. Born in Paris to aristocratic parents, he was a short, sickly, asexual hunchback, though none of it shows in any of his portraits. On the other hand, he was one of Europe's most successful military commanders. He was most noted for ridding Europe of the Muslim horde. He defeated the Turks in Wien in 1683, pushed them out of Budapest in 1686, and blasted them at the Battle of Zenta in 1697. The palace's extensive grounds rivals that of the Hofburg in area. the large palace that you see on the right of your screen is purely for entertainment. If you go down the formal garden path from right to left, you come upon the much smaller palace, which was the prince's home. Here's another perspective of both the palaces and the grounds. Turning our attention to the entertainment palace, it is notable that here, after World War II, that the Austrian State Treaty was signed in 1955. It certainly has an imposing quality about it. One of our old friends, Johann Lucas von Hildebrandt, was the architect, built to the glory of the prince. The entrance hall with the four Herculean-like figures by Lorenzo Mattielli supporting the ceiling, and strangely for me, a reminder of the big mix, you know, Michelangelo's Quattro Prigionieri in L'Accademia in Firenze. But these are fully freed. We go up the smaller staircase to the much larger formal staircase to the main hall. That staircase leads to this enormously grand porphyry marble hall. Sort of grabs you, don't it? Look up and see the glorification of the prince on the ceiling fresco. This was completed in 1720 by Carlo Corleone. Now to some glorious paintings. The Madonna del Prato by the perfect painter. What a way to start a tour. By Raphael. Bet you don't know it. Golden Mosaic Vases by, wait for it, Gustav Klimt. Here is Gustav Klimt's Judith of the Old Testament, and in the lower right-hand corner, the head of Holofernes. She did a hatchet job on him. What can I say? The kiss. A better look at the much more subdued lower Belvedere, the prince's home. It's now like a part of the upper Belvedere, an art gallery. This is an up-close and personal view of the Golden Room. A bigger look at the Golden Room. Look in the mirrors for an even bigger view. Man, was this a great afternoon. But like yesterday, we need some R&R, big time. But where? I had to consult mein Führer, Graf von der Dingsbums. And he had to go into a trance. The decision is made. Up the Himmelfort Gasse, zum Kuckuck. Down the Himmelfort Gasse, a gasse is an alley, almost zum Kuckuck is this imposing structure, part of the Austrian government's treasury department. It's actually the Prince of Savoy's uptown winter palace. You can see that it's a palace and a half. In a few seconds, you'll see mein Führer come out from window shopping to join me. Then a slow up tilt to really get a grip on the building size and one of three coats of arms of the prince himself. This is it. Zum Kuckuck. Small, exclusive, und gemütlich. As you can see, it seats about 30, run by the Weymeyer family. Frau Weymeyer just whizzed by. Now it's drool time. I'm going to give you about a minute to glance over the menu and pricing. I know what I want. Do you? Thank you. the end to an exciting day on a delightfully full note. A hidden away true Wiener restaurant serving chill Austrian white wine, venison, white asparagus, mashed potatoes with a rich brown gravy, followed by chocolate mousse with raspberries, and then sipping cognac, shared in this quiet space with a young Russian couple, coupled with the usual unemotional yet friendly face of the Graf.